Good morning, Professor Merenboer, Professor Tenkate, and Professor Stase. I'm going to be the moderator in the morning, and so I'll start by presenting Professor Merenboer, who's in charge of the first presentation. Professor Jeroen van Merenboer is full professor of learning and instruction at Maastricht University and research director of the School of Health Professions Education. He specializes in instructional designs for the health professions, and most of his research is related to cognitive load theory or four-component instructional design. Jeroen published more than 350 articles. I think now there are more than 500 book chapters, and he received numerous international awards and prizes for his research. I'm pleased to leave you now with Dr. Van Merenboer. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction, and thanks to University of Sabana for inviting me to this symposium. This presentation is about whole task learning, and especially how we can use four component instructional design, also 4CID, as a model that helps us to design educational programs based on whole task learning. Well, the contents of my presentation, I will first give a description of 4CID theory and then present some example research and development projects that are using the theory. And finally, end with some conclusions. I became interested in education in the beginning of my academic career, which is almost 40 years ago. And my first research was on computer programming and teaching computer programming. It was in the 80s, 1980s. And teaching computer programming was becoming popular because the personal computer was just invented. So a lot of people were interested in learning computer programming. The reason I started this research is that there was very low transfer from educational programs teaching people computer programming to the practice of computer programming. And many companies were complaining that they were hiring people that finished courses in computer programming, but they were not able to do so. So the transfer from the school or the educational program to the workplace was often very low. And I became interested in transfer of learning, and especially interested in instructional methods that would facilitate transfer, that would make it easier for students to apply the things they learned in school or in the educational institute at the workplace. That's actually the main reason I started to develop four-component instructional design in the late 80s. And the basic assumption, as you can already see in its name, is that educational programs that aim at transfer of learning are always built from four components. And the four components are called learning tasks, supportive information, procedural information, and part task practice. And in this educational program designed on the basis of 4CID, the learning tasks provide the backbone of an educational program, and the other three components are connected to this backbone. If you are interested in the model after listening to this presentation, you can read about the psychological basis of the model in the book Training Complex Cognitive Skills, which is already quite old. It was published in 97, so almost 25 years ago. And a more practical guide for how to apply the model when you design educational programs or curricula can you find in the book 10 Steps to Complex Learning, which is quite recently published in its third and revised edition. What I'd like to do now is go from the first to the fourth component and give some background information on each of the four components. The first component are called learning tasks. And I use the word learning tasks in a very generic sense. It can be a problem that we pose to students. It can be a project on which a small group of students is working. It can be a professional task that we provide to students or other kinds of assignments or cases. It are all examples of learning tasks. But 4CID poses a number of requirements to the learning tasks. And the first requirement is that learning tasks are preferably based on real life or professional tasks. So we take a real life task from professional practice as a starting point for designing our learning task. Note that a learning task does not need to be identical to a professional task. We take the professional task as a starting point, but we might add support and guidance and help to the task. So then it's no longer a professional task, it becomes a learning task. If we base real life learning tasks on real life tasks, they will typically be integrated, by which I mean that they do need both knowledge, skills, and attitudes from the students. You can only solve a real-life task or a well-designed learning task by making an appeal on things you know, things you can do, and particular attitudes. And this also indicates that by working on learning tasks, you develop competencies, because competencies are nothing else than combinations of knowledge, skills, and attitudes that can be applied to solve particular tasks in particular situations. When you look at this schematic representation with the circles, you also see my basic perspective on an educational program. For me, an educational program is mainly a series of tasks on which students are working, and by working on the tasks, they develop the desired competencies. Of course, we must pose more requirements on this backbone of learning tasks. And I will discuss three of them. The first requirement has to do with variability or variability of practice. And the requirement is that all tasks in an educational program must together be representative for the professional tasks that a graduated student will encounter in professional practice. So in order to prepare our students well for professional practice, they must be confronted with all the variety of tasks that can also be found in the real world, in the real profession. So the learning tasks in our educational program must be different from each other on all dimensions on which real-life tasks are also different from each other. And this requires careful planning and a careful analysis of all the tasks that occur in professional practice, in clinical practice, because otherwise our curriculum can never well represent this variability. Variability is also extremely important to reach transfer of learning. Variability enables people to develop knowledge or cognitive schemas that are general and abstract, and that allow you to apply your knowledge to new situations or new objects. I often take the butterflies that you see in the corner as an example. Everybody will say, ah, these are butterflies. And that is interesting, because when we take a close look, each butterfly is different. Some are red, some are yellow, some are green, some are big, some are small. Nevertheless, we recognize them as butterflies. It's even possible that I visit Colombia next time and go into the jungle and see a butterfly, then say, ah, that is a beautiful butterfly. I have never seen one like that. And that is transfer, because it shows that I'm able to do something, to recognize something as being a butterfly, while I've never seen one before. And that's precisely what we want from our students. From our students, we also want them to be confronted with new tasks after they graduated, and they were never confronted with this task before, but nevertheless, they are able to perform the task, to treat the patient, because they have this more general knowledge, and they can only develop this general knowledge when there is variability of practice in our educational program. This variability pertains both to surface features, things on which tasks are different, but these things do not affect the way you perform the tasks, and structural features. And that's the reason that the cognitive schema we have for recognizing butterflies also enables us to say that this insect at the bottom is not a butterfly. So variability of practice is extremely important, especially with regard to reaching transfer of learning. The second requirement deals with the complexity or the difficulty of the tasks. I think it is obvious that when we have first year students, it doesn't make sense to give them highly complex tasks that are taken from professional practice. What we typically do is give first year students very simple tasks, and then increase the complexity of the tasks over the years until students are working on a level of complexity that we might expect from a beginning professional or a student that is just graduated. So we sequence tasks from simple to complex tasks. And on each level of complexity, or task class, as it is called in four-component instructional design, we need variability. So students first work on a number of very simple tasks, then on a bit more complex tasks, and so on, until we are at a level of a beginning professional. Ideally, even the simplest tasks are meaningful tasks and represent the simplest task that a professional might encounter in real life. And when you think about a family doctor, there is a range of complexity in all the tasks and patients he will diagnose and treat, but there are also relatively simple cases, a patient with the flu, and these simple tasks will then be placed earlier in the educational program. When we look at the schematic representation, we see that this backbone of learning tasks is developing. We see that there must be variability of practice, making the whole set of tasks representative for professional life. And we see by the dotted boxes that the tasks are organized in task classes that increase in complexity over the program. Is this a new idea? No, this is a very, very old idea. Almost 100 years ago, people were already talking about a spiral curriculum. And the spiral curriculum is identical to what I just explained. The idea is that you first start practicing simple tasks, and when you master the simple task, you continue to more complex tasks, and when you master the more complex task, you keep on increasing complexity. So that's precisely what we should do in a well-designed educational program. Then there is a third requirement to the learning tasks in our curriculum, and it has to do with providing guidance and support and help to our students. So this is typically what teachers do, or what is organized in instructional materials. And in the schematic representation, it is indicated by the filling of the circles. When there is a lot of filling, it indicates that we provide a lot of guidance and support to students. And the basic idea is that when students start to work on more complex tasks, we first give them a lot of support and guidance. And we decrease support and guidance until students are able to perform the learning tasks independently without any support and guidance. And only when they show that they are able to perform tasks at a particular level of complexity independently without help and support, that's this empty circle, we can continue to a higher level of complexity. And then again, on this higher level of complexity, we first provide a lot of support and guidance, and then less and less until students are able to perform tasks at this higher level of complexity independently without support and guidance. And then we continue again to a higher level of complexity. This process is also called scaffolding, because when you build a house, when the house is going up, the scaffolds are going down. So this decreasing support and guidance on each level of complexity is what we call scaffolding. But when we look at a whole educational program, let's say a 3-year bachelor program in a medical school, there will be different levels of complexity. So this scaffolding principle yields a sawtooth pattern of support, where on each level of complexity, there is a decrease of support and guidance until students are able to perform the simple task themselves, and then support and guidance is going up again. I often compare this idea with these training wheels on the bike of a child. You provide some support, but when the child is better able to keep his balance on the bike, you can remove the wheels. This principle of scaffolding is also closely related to what Vygotsky calls the soul of proximal development. And Vygotsky is a famous educational psychologist, and he asked himself, when do students learn most? And he did a lot of work on that, and he finally came to the conclusion that our students learn most when we provide them tasks that are a bit too difficult for them. So it are really challenging tasks that they could not do independently. But thanks to the fact that we give them support and guidance, they are able to successfully complete the task. And that's precisely what we try to do here. If our students challenging tasks that are difficult for them, but at the same time provide them support and guidance so that they could successfully complete the tasks, then they are in this zone of proximal development and learning will be optimized. Well, actually, this completes my discussion of the first component. And what we see here is a backbone of learning tasks, which can be projects or simulation assignments or problems. And they are organized from simple to complex, with decreasing support and guidance on each level of complexity. And they show high variability so that the complete set of tasks is representative for the professional tasks you will encounter in clinical practice. This backbone of learning tasks serves to connect the other components to. And the second component of the 4-component instructional design model is called supportive information, but teachers often call this the theory. When I give this presentation to teachers, they typically say, well, this is all nice and easy, this talking about learning tasks, but my students must first learn the theory. Because if they don't master the theory, they will not be able to perform the tasks. Well, that makes sense. I call this supportive information. And what you see in this picture is that this supportive information is connected to task classes, to learning tasks at the same level of complexity. And the basic idea is that you need to master a particular amount of theory that enables you to perform tasks at a particular level of complexity. When you continue to more complex tasks, you typically need more theoretical knowledge that enables you to perform the more complex tasks. So the connection between supportive information and the learning tasks is at the level of complexity or task classes. In 4CID, a further distinction is made between two types of supportive information. It's supportive information about the domain and how the domain is organized. So in the medical domain, it's knowledge about the human body and the working of the organs and the relevant biochemistry and the working of particular medicines and things like that. But it's also knowledge about how to systematically approach tasks in the domain. All these systematic approaches to problem solving. So for a doctor, it's important to know that in the medical process, you first are interviewing the patients and doing physical examinations, and then you come up with the diagnosis, you ask for additional laboratory tests, and you make a treatment plan, and so forth. So these systematic approaches are also part of the supportive information. What we also see in our schematic representation is that in the 4CID model, the supportive information can be presented before students start to work on a series of equally complex learning tasks, but we can also make it available to them while they are working on these tasks. When you look at project-based education, it is quite common that students first do some reading and watch videos and visit some lectures, and then they start to work on a project. But when you look at problem-based learning, we immediately present the problem to students, and then students come up with their own learning goals and only then go into the theory. So in problem-based learning, it's actually the bottom part of the supportive information that we're dealing with. In a four-component instructional design approach, it's both possible. And the preferred method depends on the prior knowledge and prior experience of the learners. The basic idea is that for novice learners who have no knowledge of the domain, it's often better to start with the problems, like we do in problem-based learning, because the problems are concrete, they are suitable to activate prior knowledge, and then they go with this activated prior knowledge into the literature to study the literature. But when we have more experienced students who already know a lot about the domain, it makes sense to start with the presentation of the theoretical information, because they can already link this new information to the things they already know, and then they are well prepared to work on the learning tasks. So when you look at curricula that have been designed with 4CID, you can in general say that in the beginning it's more like problem-based learning, but later in the curriculum it's often more like project-based learning. Then there is a third component, and this third component is what we call procedural information. When we look at the learning tasks of course make an appeal on problem solving and reasoning and decision making aspects, and these are supported by the supportive information. But learning tasks also make an appeal on routine aspects that are always the same. And when you are a family doctor, you could say, well, each patient is different. And that's true. Each patient, each case is different. But still, there are particular aspects that are always the same, like taking the blood pressure or giving an intravenous injection or doing particular procedural physical examinations, it's always done in the same way. These are the routine aspects of the complex learning task. And these routine aspects are best learned by telling students how to do it while they are doing it. It's what we often see in a skills lab where students are practicing physical examination. The instructor is looking over the shoulder of the student and pointing out things like, no, you're holding this instrument not in the correct way. You should do it this way. So it's the information you provide just in time, precisely when students need it. And that helps them best to develop these routine aspects. That's what we see in the schematic representation, because the upward pointing arrows signify the procedural information, and it's just presented while students are working on the learning task, precisely when they need it. This is another example of the presentation of procedural information. On one screen, we see the patient, and on the other screen, we see a demonstration video. And the resident, or whatever it is watching the demonstration video, can stop the demonstration video, and then mimic what he or she saw practicing on a patient or on the simulation. So it doesn't always need to be presented firmly by an instructor, but you can also use a demonstration video. A lot of these videos you can find on YouTube. When you want to perform a particular routine, you search for the video, you play the video, and while you're watching the video, you practice it yourself. And then there is one more component that also relates to the routine aspects of the learning tasks. There might be particular routine aspects that are safety critical or very important, and that we do not only want to practice in the context of the learning tasks, but we want them to practice additionally until they are fully automated. And for these routine aspects, we then define part task practice, often in the simulation lab where learners can go to practice particular routine aspects of learning tasks. Here the example, it's a student in dentistry, and dentists make a lot of their money by drilling holes in teeth, and that is what they practice hundreds or thousands of times, not on real patients, but this is also a mannequin. So you put in the porcelain molars and teeth, and you can practice the drilling and the filling of the teeth hundreds and thousands of times until it becomes an automated routine. In 4CID, this is indicated by the small circles, the part task practice. And what is really important is that we provide part task practice in a fruitful cognitive context. That is, after the routine aspect has been introduced in the context of a whole task, so that students understand how practicing the routine might help them to improve their whole task performance. So we try to prevent the situation that students are asking, why should I learn this? And then tell them, well, you will find out later why you need it. No, they understand why they need to practice these routines, because they have already been confronted with whole meaningful tasks that made an appeal on this routine. And in terms of instruction, it's mainly repetitive practice. So part task practice is practicing something over and over and over and over again until the routine aspect of the task becomes automated. This is actually a complete schematic representation of an educational program that is based on 4CID. I often talk about complex learning, And when I talk about complex learning, I mean learning that is a combination of different fundamental learning processes. And four fundamentally different learning processes correspond with the four components of the four-component instructional design model. First, people construct cognitive schemas when they learn. And they can develop these cognitive schemas in two different ways: by inductive learning or learning by doing. And this is what is facilitated by the learning tasks. The learning tasks sustain a process of inductive learning, learning by doing, and as a result of learning by doing, people construct cognitive schemas in long-term memory. But people also construct schemas in long-term memory by connecting new information to the things they already know. And this new information may be given by a teacher, or you may read it in a book, and then it's connected or elaborated with the knowledge you already have in long-term memory. And this is a process of elaboration. So supportive information facilitates a process of elaboration. And that also contributes to schema construction. At the same time, people also automate schemas. And this mainly relates to the routine aspects. They build routines that enable pattern recognition, things that are always the same. You can easily deal with them because you have automated schemas in long-term memory to deal with it. Procedural information, the just-in-time instructions we give to students just in time, help students to form cognitive rules. Cognitive rules specifying what to do under which circumstances. The PARTAS practice aims to strengthen these rules by using them over and over and over again until you can fully automatically apply, use the routines. And I refer to this book, Training Complex Cognitive Skills. And in this book, I describe learning processes, and especially inductive learning, elaboration, rule formation, strengthening, and explain how these four learning processes can be simultaneously promoted by a well-designed educational program that then needs to be built from the four components. And that's complex learning. It's not learning that is particularly difficult, but it's learning that is complex in the sense that it is built from four different types of learning processes. Okay, so 4CID is a rather old model. The first publication is from 92, so that is almost 30 years old. It was originally developed in industrial training, so a lot of research in the early days of the model was done in ICT and computer programming, in chemical industry, in aviation, aircraft maintenance, and fields like that. But since 12 years, it is also becoming more and more popular in medical education. And of course, it is used in more and more curriculum development projects in nursing, but nowadays also in several medical schools. But today I'd like to focus a bit more on the research and development projects, because for me, 4CID is of course a model that can be used to design educational programs. Excuse me, but it's also a theory that is continuously refined and updated by doing experiments. So it's also driving new research. And today I'd like to focus a bit on a few projects doing research and development based on 4CID. And the first project is applying 4CID to simulation-based training in obstetrics. And one of my PhD students, Brainerd Melo, she's from Brazil. Maybe she's participating, I don't know. But Brainerd Melo did a PhD project on simulation-based training in obstetrics. And she did a study in which she was first looking for the best practice simulation training for postpartum hemorrhage that she could find. Because a lot of these simulation-based training programs were developed in the literature. And the best program she could find is what we call the best practice simulation. And then she took this best practice simulation and redesigned it on the basis of 4CID design principles. So it was redesigned. And then she compared the two training programs with regard to their effectiveness. So she measured performance of all the different aspects of the skills involved and the time it takes to complete those skills. So she was also looking at how quick students were in dealing with the postpartum hemorrhage. There is a video in which Brina is explaining this project herself. So I will see if that works here, and if we can start the video.
Nothing much happens, Jeroen, so I'm not sure what's wrong.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you have the link to see if our support in IT help us?
I'm sorry, I understand the video doesn't work, which is not surprising because videos typically don't work in situations like this, but I will just explain it myself. So Brena was comparing two types of simulation, one best practice simulation that was taken from the literature and a redesign of this simulation that was redesigned on the basis of 4CID principles. And as we can see on this slide, the 4CID redesign showed positive effects on many of the aspects that were assessed, like communication, Phoenix access, laboratory evaluation, and also speed measures. Here we see this speed measures, so you can see that many of the necessary skills for postpartum hemorrhage were completed much faster in the redesigned simulation-based training program than in the original simulation-based program. Especially within 1 minute, within 60 seconds, you already see that the instructional design post-test, that's the upper line, is going up much faster than the other lines. And that is important because it shows that critical skills were applied very fast after participating in the 4CID-based simulation program. If you want to read more, I added some references. So this was published in the International Journal of Gynecology and Obstetrics. Another Another line of research is looking into blended learning. And especially nowadays with COVID-19, blended learning is becoming more and more popular. What we know from review studies is that well-designed blended learning can be equally effective as face-to-face learning, that students often perceive it as equally attractive, but they find blended learning more demanding than face-to-face education. And we also know that frequent quizzes or self-tests are really important in blended learning situations because they can help students to inform them about progress. In 4CID, we are actually interested in two types of blends. And a term I sometimes use is double blended learning. The first blend is the familiar blend between face-to-face and online learning. So this first blend in the bottom of this picture assumes that we present the supportive information online and we present the learning tasks face to face. And then we add a second blend, and this is particularly interesting, I think. When we look at the learning tasks at a particular level of complexity, we first present learning tasks that are provided with a lot of support and guidance in a simulated task environment, which can be a computer simulation or a simulation lab or a skills lab. But then, on this level of complexity, students also perform tasks with less support and guidance at a workplace or in clinical practice. And only then, we continue to a higher level of complexity, where we start with simulation-based tasks again, but immediately on the same level of complexity, continue to workplace learning. So this is also intertwining formal education with workplace learning on each level of complexity. Well, we did quite a lot of projects dealing with double blended learning. This is one example from the University of Leuven in Belgium. And this was a project they did in their training program for family practitioners, family doctors. In this program, they developed quite a lot of courses. And as you can see, all the courses are dealing with real life cases, real life learning tasks. Courses dealing with the diabetic patient, children with fever, care for the elderly, low back pain, tired patients, and so forth. When you focus on one of these courses, the contents of the courses are described here, and you can see that the kind of symbols they are using to explain the design of the courses are very similar to the symbols I've been using in my presentation so far. And this is an overview of the module patient with diabetes, and you immediately see that in this course there are four levels of complexity, and you can also see how many learning tasks there are at each level of complexity. In this course, they make a distinction between the different types of learning tasks. And we have individual computer-based tasks, individual computer-based tasks in which students must prepare for group meetings at the educational institute. There are learning group activities, but, and this is the most important thing, there are also tasks that must be performed at the workplace. Because these family doctors in training, they participate in the practice of a family doctor for 2 or 3 days a week, and the other days they are at the educational institute. So we really have one educational design where on each level of complexity, students perform tasks both in a simulated setting, which can be computer simulation or using a simulation lab or a skills lab, but also related tasks in real clinical practice. So this is really, I think, a very strong way to integrate learning in the educational institute and learning at the workplace with each other. Well, this is just an example to see that there are also part-task practice involved in these courses. Here, this is what they call spot diagnosis, quick pattern recognition, development of pattern recognition to recognize children's diseases. Well, the findings have been reported in Medical Teacher a few years ago, but they're still working on these courses, which they call lifelike learning. Program evaluations show very positive effects of this innovation. Students and teachers are satisfied with it, and data collection is still ongoing in newly developed courses. When you go to the University of Leuven, they have a website called Lifelike Learning, where you can find more more information. But this idea of double blended learning is something that nicely fits a 4CID approach and that we also apply in many other projects. So far, I mainly talked about the educational program and the learning tasks as if all students are working on the same tasks. Yet we also do projects based on 4CID in which we are looking at individualized learning trajectories, meaning that different students can work on different tasks depending on their individual needs. So, not one series of learning tasks that is identical for all students, but offering students the opportunity to select their own task based on assessments, including self-assessments, that are registered in a development portfolio. And in a development portfolio, we assess performance on all different aspects for all tasks that students are working on, so that we have good information on the strong points and the weak points of a particular student. And then the student, with his or her teacher or coach, can decide on new tasks to work on. And ideally, these new tasks should make it possible to improve, to work on the weak aspects of performance. So we should select future tasks that are at the right level of difficulty for a particular student, that provide the right level of guidance for a particular student, and that ensure variation. So this is another type of project we are running and in which we try to figure out how you can build flexible, individualized or personalized programs based on 4CID. Self-assessment plays an important role here, and what I like about this approach is that we ask students to reflect on the task they performed, but not just reflection for the reflection, but they reflect in order to identify weak aspects in their own performance, and then plan or select new tasks that enable them to improve on those aspects. So reflection in our approach serves reflection, serves the planning of new tasks, new goals. I often compare this with being the passenger in a car. And suppose you are in the passenger seat and the driver asks you to check the rear view mirror to see if there is no traffic coming from behind. So you are asked to reflect while you are not in the driver's seat. You would probably say to the driver, well, are you crazy? Why should I look in the rear view mirror? Why do you want me to reflect? I have no control over it. So you are the one who should reflect. Nevertheless, I've seen a lot of educational programs in which we ask our students to reflect on what they did without giving them any control over the things they will be doing in the future. So then we should not be surprised when students are not very eager to do our reflection exercises. And we should not be surprised when students are copying and pasting reflection reports from the internet. I think that reflection is important, but only when it is combined with planning, giving students the responsibility to plan their own learning. And of course, they do this together with their teacher, together with a coach, but they must have some control over it, otherwise a reflection doesn't make sense. This is one example in which we applied these principles. It's in a nursing program. And in this nursing program, we developed a structured database with learning tasks. We called it Care Village. Students had to work on those tasks, both in the school setting and at the workplace, because this was again a dual learning program in which students spent a few days a week in a particular clinical setting, and the other days of the week they spent at the educational institute in the school. And these students had a development portfolio in which all the tasks they performed both in the school and at the workplace were listed, and all the tasks were assessed so that we could monitor the progress of the students over learning tasks and also see what their points of improvement were and what their strong points were. And they had coaching meetings with their teacher to plan future learning each 2 or 3 weeks. Well, this is what Care Village looked like. It was a research project, so it's not very fancy, but these are the different settings that students have to deal with. The hospital, a psychiatric hospital, a hospital for the elderly, home care, there is a library, there is the school. So the different settings in which they can do internships are represented, and the school and the library are represented to search for information and to meet teachers and so forth. They can click on a particular setting, and then they receive an overview of available learning tasks in this particular setting. So this is what you see if you click on psychiatric hospital, and there are a number of learning tasks, and all these tasks are based on real patients. So all the files, all the information is of course anonymized, but it is taken from real patients. Also the real systems are used. So this is very close to reality. And students receive the learning tasks and the assignments. So this is a description of a patient that must be taken care of. With a file. If they click on the file, they get a real file with all the background information on this patient. There is a sketch of the situation, and there is a specification of things to do. And I'm sorry, this is in Dutch, but the interesting thing is that each assignment specifying what to do has elements that must be performed in the school setting, and it has elements that must be performed at the workplace. So again, we try to integrate workplace learning with learning in the school. This is the portfolio. So on the one hand, we have the learning tasks, and on the other side are the performance standards that must be reached. This portfolio is updated for each task that is performed, which can be a task in the educational institute or a task at the workplace. And this is the basis for discussions between the students and the coaches to decide on new learning tasks. And this system works quite well. We are still working on defining it, but nowadays, at least in the Netherlands, there is a lot of interest in flexibilization and modularization of educational programs. And 4CID seems to be a quite effective approach to help students and their teachers to develop individualized learning trajectories because we can use the learning tasks as the units for building these individualized trajectories and developing portfolio as an instrument that allows us to make decisions. Final example I'd like to give is dealing with serious games, because serious games are also becoming more and more popular, also in medical education. And the learning tasks in 4CID are typically performed in a simulated or real environment, and many games offer a simulated environment. So 4CID can be used as a basis for the development of serious simulation-based games. And I've listed some games that are based on 4CID methodology. And the one I'd like to discuss here, and we are working on it, is the ABCDE game. It's a game for training emergency skills according to the ABCDE method, where you first check the airway, then the breathing, circulation, disability, exposure. So it's a systematic approach for how to deal with critically ill patients. One of my former PhD students, Mary Dankbaar, did research on the original version of this game. And she found that this was a very effective game for teaching emergency skills to medical residents. And she was interested in the question if this game would also be useful to teach medical students, undergraduate students, rather than residents. And she tested that with medical students, and she looked at learning outcomes, motivation, and cognitive load of these students. Well, this is the setup. We had a control group with no game, no cases, a cases group in which the cases were presented as text, and the game group in which the cases were presented as simulated cases in the game. And of course, the hypothesis was that the game would be more motivating and that students would learn more from the game. Well, these are the main findings. Students worked 2 hours longer on the open cases in the game compared to the controls. Students working with the game were more engaged and experienced higher load than the other two groups. So the game was really motivated. Students liked playing the game. They put a lot of effort and time in it. Yet, we did not find any difference in learning outcomes between the three groups. All groups did equally well on a post-test. And we came up with an explanation based on 4CID and cognitive load theory, namely that games are motivating, that students are willing to invest a lot of effort in it, but investing effort will only work if the tasks are in this zone of proximal development. If the tasks are not only challenging, but can also be solved with enough support and guidance. So what we're currently doing is redesigning the game. We are adding additional complexity levels, especially more simple cases to the game. We are adding more innovative approaches to providing support and guidance to students, so that we are better able to adapt the cases in the game to the level of experience of the students. And this process is still on its way, but the redesign of the game is ready now. And another PhD student, Tjitske Faber, is preparing experiments in which we will test if this new version of the game is also useful for undergraduate students and not only for residents. Well, that brings me to my conclusions. We've seen that 4CID provides the theoretical basis not only for curriculum design projects, but also for a lot of research and development projects in which we test new ideas based on 4CID. And at the same time, the 4CID theory is further developing based on the results of those studies. Today, I focused a bit on technology-enhanced learning. We had to look at design of simulation-based training programs in obstetrics, double-blended learning, in which we mix workplace learning with learning in the educational institute, the use of electronic development portfolios to support personalized and individualized learning trajectories, and serious gaming. And I think this makes clear that 4CID and similar models are really helpful to drive educational innovations, to test new ideas, and finally come up with evidence-based or evidence-informed instructional design approaches. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Van Meerenboer. We have one question, so long. Maybe we will have more during our panel. But Andres Leal asks, how do you implement this model in medical schools without simulation units or simulation laboratories?
There are two answers. Of course, you can try to implement it by using the simple kinds of simulation. I mean, when we talk about simulation, many people immediately think about simulation laboratories. But role play is also simulation. And role play is a very old simulation technique for which you do not need any equipment or fancy laboratories. Problems like we use in problem-based learning are often also a form of simulation. Yeah, then you have a written text, and the written text says, suppose you are a doctor and a patient is coming into your room and the patient has this and this symptoms, what would you do? It's also a form of simulation. So I use simulation in a very broad sense, and one extreme can be written based problems, and the other extreme are high fidelity simulation labs. And ideally, when you use 4CID, you have this whole continuum of simulation at your disposal. But if you do not have the high fidelity simulation facilities or the computer based simulation facilities, you can still use many, maybe not all, but many ideas from the model by using low fidelity simulation, like problem cases, like role play, and so forth.
Thank you. One last question before we move on to Professor Ol. Do you think we could combine different structural design models, for example, apprenticeship cognitive model with 4CID in different moments of undergraduate students? What do you think of this combination?
Cognitive apprenticeship has quite a lot of methods in common with 4CID. Scaffolding is also in cognitive apprenticeship learning. The variation is there, and so many of the methods are comparable. A strong point of cognitive apprenticeship learning is that it pays a lot of attention to the cultural aspects, the importance of professionalization at the workplace. So that certainly adds to 4CID. When it comes to the different instruments that you can use for sequencing tasks, different ways of providing support and guidance, I think 4CID provides more guidance. But yes, you can combine models, of course.
Okay, thank you. That was a question from our leader, our director of the Master's Medical Education, Dr. Restrepo. And one last one now, and it's Sara Arias. She asks, what do you do with students that do not meet the objectives in the activities or for the 4CID? How do you deal with students that are having problems? Any special approaches?
You can use 4CID in different ways, and you can use it to make a program where all students work on the same learning tasks, So it's a one-size-fits-all program. And then it's much more difficult to deal with students who are not reaching the objectives. For example, the objectives to go from one level of complexity to a higher level of complexity. And what you could do then is ask students who are not ready to go to a higher level of complexity to redo the previous level of complexity, which is a very rough system. I would not be in favor of it, but that's what you could do in a fixed curriculum. Nowadays, a lot of my own research is dealing with flexibilization and modularization. And what we do then is continuously setting out learning trajectories that take the individual needs of learners into account using a development portfolio. And then it's possible that one student needs 10 tasks to reach the objectives, and another student only needs 7 tasks to reach the objectives, and yet another student needs 12 tasks to reach the objectives. So then you have much more flexibility in your educational program. And especially when you're dealing with more heterogeneous groups of students, bringing in this flexibility is very helpful, I think.